their woes and worries have got compounded due to fear and uncertainty, death and distress all around. The issues with which most of our students are grappling with are: where I want to go next, what I should work on, and how should I work to achieve my goals. The idea behind holding this series is to help our students explore answers for some of these questions, if not all. We intend to help them in career exploration, career planning, and above all, want to empower them and help them in achieving their career goals. We are so thankful to our alumni who are coming forward to support our efforts in this regard. Bringing together our current batch of students and alumni on this KMC Alumni Net platform has allowed KMC pride to flow. As an academic institution, we at KMC very well understand that alumni are the reflection of our past. They represent our present and act as a link to our future. We desire for cultivating a strong and a positive relationship with our alumni who can benefit their alma mater socially, academically, and professionally with their wealth of knowledge and skills. And we intend to leverage the alumni community and want to create a win-win situation for both our reputed Hiroshima College and our very own alumni. I'm taking this opportunity to urge from this platform to all our alumni to kindly fill up the Google form placed on various social media platforms and college website, and do join the official Hiroshima College Alumni Network. Coming now to today's session, I extend a very warm welcome to my student, Ms. Kanika Goyal, and our alumna from class of 2019. Our alumna has been selected recently as RA in Reserve Bank of India. And she is the first speaker under this series on building career paths. I request our principal madam, Professor Vibha Singh Chauhan, who is an inspiration and pillar of strength for this Hiroshima College Alumni Network, to kindly deliver her welcome address. Over to you, ma'am. Ma'am, you are muted.
Thank you very much, Dr. Joshi. Always a pleasure to listen to you, and always a pleasure to come and meet our alumni, see them, interact with them, and see them lead and steer themes, discussions, present students in directions which are sometimes very new, exciting, and challenging. And today's speaker, Kanika Goyal, she's here. Thank you, Kanika, for coming. And the college actually, and college activities and groups always stay with the one. We say, well, we leave, we have left college, but actually college never leaves us. And all of us carry our institutions within us, and I'm grateful to all the members of the alumni members, and especially Professor Seema Joshi, who has taken the lead to give this a structure. And it started in February, and the response was very, very cheering, and we followed the lead, and instead of a foundation day, actually we had the foundation month in February this year, and it was all due to the continuous and close involvement of our alumni. Actually, it's you, the alumni, who have given us the hope to move ahead, and our major task is to really bring everybody in the fold of college. And from our very, very fresh alumni to older ones, senior alumni, because I think each generation, each age has its own, you know, contribution towards creating institutions, systems. And so I am very, very glad to be here today to be, and I'm looking forward to listen to Kanika on a theme which is very important, as Professor Joshi said, that it's important and sometimes it's a pressure. Sometimes because of not knowing the various avenues which are getting added on actually with changes in technology, systems, markets, investment systems, etc. Sometimes our students and your college mates, they may not be aware of it. And therefore, this is a most, most welcome move, idea by the Alumni Network. And I really welcome the today's speaker as well as all the participants. And the participants who are there, very warm welcome. I'm sure you will be enriched by what Kanika has to say. And this is, we began in February, and these are this is another step. And the alumni connection with college is actually an ongoing process. So I hope we keep moving on. And we also learn in the process. We learn how to structure, what to do. And we are in the process of formalizing the alumni network. And I was a little pleasantly surprised when I wrote the acronym for Karurimal College Alumni Network. And then I realized that if you read it, it reads as KM Can. So KM Can. And we can, you can. And I was delighted that that is what it reads like. It was incidental when I wrote it down, but it's a pleasure to see. And also it, in a way, almost an indication, yeah, we can, KM Can. So KM Can, the Alumni Network can. And as Professor Joshi said, that we are waiting for more and more students to join, our alumni to join in. And of all ages, all groups. And now, of course, it is with the younger lot who have spent a fair amount of time with us, structuring this, organizing this. So very, very warm welcome. And all the best. I hope the pandemic gets over soon and we are able to meet most of you physically. So thank you and welcome.
Thank you so much for this, for that address, ma'am. We'll be moving forward now. Genuinely, it is my honor to introduce our guest for the evening, Ms. Kanika Goyal. I was speaking with her yesterday and the achievements she listed, they were spellbounding, honestly. So Kanika is an economics graduate from Karurimal College, class of 2019, and has recently completed her master's in economics, that too from Indian Institute of Foreign and Trade. She has held various internship opportunities. I'm sure we can learn a lot. At different capacities, driven and inspired by the penchant of research with the EEPC India, promoted by Ministry of Commerce. Secondly, with CRISIL as an analytics intern and Delhi-based startup named Traco Solutions. She even represented IIFT at the UNCTAD Summer School and got selected for the mentorship program and has expertise in disciplines of international trade and finance. Presently, she is associated with Women in Econ and Policy as a member of organizing committee, and she will now be joining CAFRAL, the research department of RBI. Kanika, handing over the mic to you. We'd genuinely love to hear what you have to say.
Thank you so much, Nishkarsh, for the warm welcome, and thank you so much, Seema ma'am and Principal for such lovely and kind words. I'm really, truly honored by this opportunity that you have all presented to me, and I really want to thank Seema ma'am for being the biggest support system and coming up with this great initiative, as well as the organizing team, the participants, and all the efforts that you guys are putting in to make this event a success. So frankly, to be very honest, when Seema ma'am contacted me to share my journey, I felt I was just a little too young, you know, to have just started my career journey. So through this session, I would like to discuss more on the thought process behind my decisions, as well as the setbacks that I faced the 3 years of graduation. And I hope that even one of you gets inspired and you feel confident and hopeful about your professional future and irrespective of the course that you are going to take. So I really do believe that as much as, you know, you have heard about people's success stories, their accomplishments, it's equally important for you to know about their failures as well. Even Elon Musk's journey would not have been a steep career path, right? So even my journey was not complete without some bumps on the road. I entered KM. So there were so many nuts and programs going on for all the societies. And even after being guided by the seniors, I know that I firmly believe that there was a trade-off involved between joining societies, attending classes, as well as scoring good. So as I wanted to pursue masters, my only agenda was scoring marks. And I even dreaded applying for placement set because of the time devotion it supposedly asked for. And I joined only the economic society, that is the ESOC. So my setback here was that I did not get the chance to build up a network that that DU can offer you. So that is why at IIFC, when I came, despite of the rigorous course structure that a master's program offers, I planned on saying yes to as many opportunities that came my way. So because of that, I got the opportunity to connect with as many people and as many seniors, professionals, professors of my own college and people associated with international communities, the State Bank of India, chief economists from multiple banks. Yeah. So what I believe now is that when you pave way for an opportunity and open, you know, one path towards yourself, then other opportunities automatically start paving themselves to you. So I know that most of you are in your second or third semester already. So my advice to you would be, it's never too late. And start finding a way to say yes to as many opportunities as possible. Say yes to internship opportunities or new course. You can upgrade your skills from, you know, courses like Demi, Coursera, Data Camp, and always try to, you know, meet new people from diverse backgrounds out of your comfort zone. Because there is no place better than you and our college, which offers you to connect with people from all domains possible. Because KM has courses from science, commerce, and arts and everything. So this is the best place for you to connect with as many people from different domains as you can. And indeed, I truly agree that it is not feasible for you to say yes to all the opportunities, right? So now what is the main criteria that you need to follow your interest and passion? I know in the initial years, you must be getting opportunities of social media marketing, promotion, internships. And even I felt that why would I be doing them? You know, like after scoring 95% plus in boards and then landing up to one of the best colleges in DU, why would I be doing all these promotion activities? So, but the thing is that you need to start from somewhere. And these kind of internships might actually help you building in communication skills. And if you're actually wanted to pursue some sales or marketing in MBA for say, then these internships can actually help you out. But it is also true that it might not be feasible for you to achieve your dream job. Then what you can do is, if you can actually differentiate yourself from thousands of people, other students who are pursuing the same course as you are, from DU, from other colleges like Narasimha Reddy or IIT. So what you can do is, you can upgrade your skills and then you can start applying for other opportunities. For that, you need to learn the art of cold emailing and reach out to people on LinkedIn. So, and this is a fact that most of us self-reject ourselves, that we are not capable of applying to a particular job or a particular company. So never do that. Never ever self-reject yourself and do not think you're not suitable enough for, you know, applying for a particular job at a particular company or pursuing a particular course. And this will help you, you know, learn the art of multitasking as well and strike a balance between work culture. This is what is required. And I would suggest that I have personally helped in terms of possibilities in various capacities, as Nishkarsh just told you. So I have worked in a startup
in community organizations as well as I've worked with corporates. So I wanted to, you know the industry as well after working with the Ministry of Commerce. So I started looking out for opportunities because after, you know, the placement crisis completed, company placement sentiment come up with the opportunities, but I really wanted to get a flavor of the corporate as well. So what I did was I started cold emailing as well as searching out for people at LinkedIn. And I luckily I got the opportunity of working as analyst at Switzerland. And where I really did learn a lot of things. For example, I learned credit rating, like got to network with some of the biggest international firms. And I got to study, you know, the sentiment index of people and the firms which have been impacted due to COVID. But the biggest realization for me was that my real interest lies in research. And I think this was the biggest self-awakening call for me. So my penchant for research actually, you know, guided me to take as many research meetings as possible. I even applied to summer schools so that I'm able to connect with more professors internationally and get to know their point of view on different areas of, you know, topics as well. So, and I'm so glad that I'm all, you know, after doing all these research projects and working professors, now I'm on the onset of publishing my own dissertation as an independent author. So that is really a big achievement for me. And after, you know, I'm talking about my failures, I'm talking with RBI. So yeah, anyone who would be, you know, dreaming of doing a master's in economics would definitely be thinking of applying to BSc, PCLO, the college of government. This is the dream college for us. But and some of you would be interested to apply for IS as well. But my dream college was IGIS, because you know, it at the top of my summer, I thought that, you know, that college is affiliated with RBS and that can give me a chance of doing summer placement at RBS. So I was thinking that I will definitely work hard for IGIS. But because of, you know, some reasons, I could not clear the exam. And I think I thought, chalo, koi nahi, let's apply for other colleges. And I ended up at IIFT. So even at IIFT, some selected students got the chance of, you know, professors to send their applications to some placements over there. But I was selected for my applications being sent, but I didn't get selected over there as well. So I didn't know that, you know, I didn't dream that I'll get to work at RBI sometime. So I started applying for resource opportunities at different institutions, say IMA, and then there are other corporates and other institutions who offer you research roles. And somewhere, you know, I got this opportunity that there's a role of in the CAPL team. So CAPL is basically the Center of Advanced Financial Research and Advanced Learning, which is a department which comes under RBI, and it offers research roles. And it is really good for people who actually are interested in domains of macroeconomics, finance, and research related to banking. So that is what I think. It was a perfect mix of opportunities I was looking for. And I really did put in all my efforts and gave my application, submitted my application, then got selected. And eventually things kept happening. There's one interview led to another, and I finally get the phone. One day I'm happy, you know, working there. So yeah, dreams and destiny, I think they you know, play a big role for you. So what my advice is that, so buy some opportunities, you know, will definitely upgrade your skills for dreams. For example, EPC, Ministry of Commerce definitely has been doing so. But if some opportunities, for example, especially for me, was a self-awakening call. So these are internships that help you take more informed decisions in what you really want to do. And this is really a big advice that, you know, some of you, even people at my, people, you know, coming from my batchmates, thought that they will do multiple internships at the same time. For example, they are, you know, holding to 2 to 3 opportunities just in one semester. Please don't do that, and don't do all these opportunities, you know, don't take these opportunities just for the sake of skill building. You need to actually learn from this. So authenticity, being true to all these positions, and consistency is actually the key to learning. And no one actually asks you from the, you know, interview will ask you that, oh, what did you do in that organization? What did you? They will obviously ask you, what did you learn from them, and how can you you know, apply all those learning and all those things to that organization that you are applying for. So never do that, and not boring you for my you know, final suggestion would be that, firstly, have an experimental attitude and embrace the wisdom of uncertainty that deep offers you with. And Italy, there's a very famous saying that goes around that, you know, you become the average of the 5 persons you surround yourself with. And I really believe in this fact, but I also believe that you should actually try to become one of those 5 persons that people would, you know, want to be surrounded with. So why not become that one person, and you will obviously, you know, then get acquainted with all those 5 people you admire and inspire from. And finally, do not procrastinate. And understand the importance of short-term goals. I know that we hear people asking, you know, what do you, where do you see yourself in 5 years down the line? And frankly, with all the uncertainties around and the pandemic that we're stuck in, I have realized this, I really don't know. Even I don't know where I see five years or 10 years down the line. But what I do know is that I want to upgrade myself every 6 to 12 months. So we can decide upon, what we can decide upon is that what are we going to do in the next few months. So you can plan your next 12 to 18 months of your college journey, and how by each passing each semester you can add value to yourself. So yeah, that pretty much sums up what I have to say to you all. So I hope you get to learn something from this talk. And thank you, Seema ma'am, for this opportunity.
You're always welcome. And I'm very glad that you took out time before you joined here to meet our, you know, young students in the college and to guide them. Because whatever you have learned through your experience, I can recollect when you were in first semester. So I, like when I saw your profile on LinkedIn, I was impressed that this is the same Kanika. So I was really impressed, Kanika. And I wish you all the best before you, you know, join RBI. And I wish that you should give your best, right?
Thank you so much, ma'am. It's always a pleasure to come back.
We'll keep calling you.
It's my pleasure.
Your voice is breaking, Kanika. So, stable connection, I think, is not there. Stable connection you are having. Your voice is breaking. I want that, you should be audible to everybody.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just check one.
Yeah, you just check, please. Nishkarsh, you can continue.
Thank you, Kanika, for that address. So throughout this whole call, we've been having a lot of questions in the chat box. So Kanika, if you don't mind, I'll be asking you these questions one by one, if that's fine with you.
Oh yeah, just to check, Nishkarsh, am I audible now?
Yeah, you're perfectly audible now.
Okay, thanks. So we can continue with the questions and answers.
So the most important question that I'm getting again and again is, how do you decide that after college you have to go for either master's or a job or an MBA? How do you choose between all these three options?
Yeah, I think I was having a talk with Seema ma'am today morning that, you know, so many people ask me to follow, you know, MBA. So there's a constant drift. I don't know about jobs, but you definitely know once that if you want to pursue some higher studies, whether to go for an MBA or whether to specialize in the, you know, subject of your guides. So that was a clear drift between, you know, and I was so confused for entire second year that what should I opt for? I was asking opinions from, every second people I was seeing. So what should I opt for? So that is actually very confusing. And I think that is when you should follow your interest. Matlab, every time I used to hear that, you know, master's is a long journey. It will take you 7 to 8 years, maybe more than that, to settle down. Maybe if you will be pursuing a PhD, or maybe if you will be working as a professor or anything else, supposedly, it will take you around twice the time it will take you after having completed your master's MBA journey. So to, you know, have the same pay scale, to have the same recognition. So don't follow, you know, don't look at the salary base, don't look at the number of years it is going to take you. Just follow your interest, because that is where, you know, after 10 to 15 years, you will be at the same position. Maybe, I think, at the earlier stage only. So just follow your interest, because that is what you are going to do after, you know, so many years. So do not regret. And if some people, and then, you know, if they want to pursue MBA, then they are confused, you know, whether to take VOCEX and then apply to MBA colleges or directly apply to MBA colleges. That is, again, a very tricky question on my, and as many people as I have come across. So for applying to foreign colleges and for, I think, ISB as well, for even IMEs, they think that the people who will be coming and they will be competing for placements at the school, so they will be more experienced, they will be more skilled, they would have more experience of working at the corporate. So why would the companies be selecting them over people who are coming with work ex already? So it all depends on your mind, your mind, and it all depends on what you want to do. So I cannot give a clear idea whether to pursue a job or directly apply for B schools, but yeah, definitely go for your interest, choosing between any master's course or MBA. Yeah.
Okay, I think that's a great response. So before I move on to the other questions, there is one interesting one, which asks that how is your experience in RBI? I mean, how is your experience at RBI? I mean, working for RBI.
So yeah. So it's only a month, a week or two that I've joined. So I've not actually learned a lot about the organization, about the working, but definitely from the technical test itself, I was given this technical test where, I was asked to perform the event study methodology that when RBI, RBI keeps announcing, news about the repo rate, the reverse repo rate, the NPA policies and different policies. But how do these, policies affect firms, affect banking structures, affect people, affect consumers? All these studies are, falling under event study methodologies. So I was really, fascinated by the insightful technical test. And that is when I thought that, I really definitely want to do this. And working at RBI, so I'll be working as research associate under research directors. So there are different research directors who are, working directly with the cabinet ministries. They are working with RBI chief economist and governor of RBI, and we are helping them in portfolio formations, obviously, and they're also reading their independent research papers. So I'll get the opportunity to co-author all those research papers, as well as help them as a, helping hand in the research work, the data work. Yeah.
Okay. So one question I had was, it was a pretty interesting question. Someone asked that, do leap of faith still, do they still work in today's environment and competitive world? I mean, can I just go out there and try to get a job without having a plan in mind beforehand? Does that system still work? So the question is, do leap of faith still work? As in, can I just go out there and try to do something without having a plan in mind? Plan of action in mind beforehand and just go for it. Does that kind of system still work for us?
Yeah, I think not completely. Obviously, you can actually, planning is the fundamental stage of anything. Obviously, plans don't work according to you, but you should never stop planning. You always have to plan for yourself. If you lose control on what you want in the future years and what you can succeed, how you can succeed, then, you will give the opportunity to others, to your parents, to your friends, to decide and make decisions for yourself. If you're not planning, and if you're not having a career path, if you're not having what you will be, doing for the job, so how will you be able to decide and take decisions for yourself? You will be allowing your manager to take decisions for you. They'll ask that, okay, you can, join this particular team to this particular work, but this might not interest you. So you need to have a plan of action somewhere back in your mind. But it is also true that plans don't work according to your vision, So yeah, but having a plan of action is definitely a must-have. I think that answers your question first.
Yeah, it does. So next question. Does more number of internships add more value to your CV?
Value to your CV. Hi, Akul. Yeah, I read your question. So definitely it does. But as I just said, that some, I have batchmates at IFT as well, who did almost 7 to 8 internships in a tenure of 2 years. then there are people who do only two internships and the tenure of 2 years. So it actually depends on what you are learning from those opportunities. If you're not dating, if you're just, you know, taking all those opportunities just to add and put them in your CV, but we'll have, you know, got selected and we will soon get the certificate of internship, then there's no, you know, point of even applying. If you're, you know, applying even one opportunity, then see that what you are actually seeing out of it. If you are able to learn, you know, as much as possible from even one internship, then it will do. The organization will never ask you that how many internships you have done, how many societies have you taken part in. So just do the justice to whatever opportunities you are doing. And yeah, multiple opportunities will definitely add to your CV because they will see that you are, you know, able to multitask and you have experience of of working in multiple domains. Definitely it will do add to your CV.
Okay, so that's a great answer. Apart from that, I have just one more question. So obviously, so there is this phase in every student's life where they're applying to a bunch of internships, let's say 6-7 internships, but rejection comes from everywhere. You can't deny that fact. So I mean, most of the times this thing happens. How did this happen with you as well?
Yes, definitely. I was rejected for a lot of organizations, you know, while I was applying for Crystal, you know, small and, you know, these startups were, you know, rejecting. We definitely wanted to have a corporate opportunity as well because I only interned with EPC and while we're interning, you know, in this online mode, we don't actually get to, you know, meet people in person. So how will we actually know what work is actually going on behind the, you know, behind our Zoom screen? So I could not, you know, take up on research just on the basis of one internship. So definitely I want to try on Crystal. And I'm telling you, Crystal is such a big organization, but small organizations have rejected me. And, you know, rejections are actually pretty, you know, they make you doubt yourself, your capabilities. But even actually, you know, you just need to upgrade your skills and never stop believing in yourself and keep emailing HRs, keep connecting with them on LinkedIn. And, you know, connect to seniors as well. They can refer you for different job positions. You know, at the time when, you know, placements at ISU were not pretty good because of the COVID situation. So many people, you know, actually got job offers because of vessels only. So connecting with seniors, connecting with people who are actually working, right now working in good organizations will eventually help you out as well. So keep in touch with people and keep in touch with HRs. And they will actually help you out. So we make friends for, you know, our excitement. Like, we'll have fun, we'll hang out. So you need to, you know, have some friends for your corporate and for your research in your head as well. So make friends on LinkedIn. In you know, apart from doing Instagram and Facebook, you should always spend some time, some part of your day on LinkedIn. Yeah.
Okay, so those are great answers. So I have just two more questions, so please bear with us.
No,
I got one right now. So you mentioned that we should connect with people on LinkedIn, over LinkedIn, right? So connecting with someone over LinkedIn is great, but how do you actually ask them for internships and jobs?
Yeah, so definitely, you know, in the niche, when I was actually starting, you know, using LinkedIn for building connections, what I used to do was I was, you know, connecting with the HRs and directly sending them opportunities. So this is the particular opportunity that is coming, that is a opening IPC on your company's website. So can you refer me for the same? So that is a wrong, you know, that is a wrong thing to start up with. That person doesn't know you. Even your friend might not refer you for the same. So how can you expect a stranger or an HR of a company to refer you? So what you can do is, you know, kind of talk them on the LinkedIn and then see what their interests like, what are they posting about, and then, you know, try to have a common, you know, networking, have a common think of interest to start a conversation, and then you definitely connect with them on LinkedIn and you can say that, you know, you have been working on these details and all these things really interest me and these are this that I have developed over years. And I think that I'll be a great fit for your organization. And then you start the conversation. And then after some time, if you think that person has to connect with you, then ask him for or her for a reference. So that is how connecting with the region would work.
Okay, I understand. So that was an interesting point, finding common points of interest and then taking the conversation from there. So moving on to the last question.
Yeah.
So that's in the chat box, actually. What were some questions asked to you during your interview at RBI? And what's something that employers seek in a candidate?
So basically, there were 3 to 4 rounds that I had at RBI. So basically, since this particular question is particularly asking about my interview questions, so I had 2 rounds of interviews. First was the technical round, because obviously we wanted to research. So they want to see what is my theoretical base and how can I apply all those theoretical ideas to research to practical implications. So they asked me drilling questions and queries on Black-Scholes model, if you would be familiar with corporate finance. I really don't think so. So all these CAPM models. Grilling me if I actually know the concept and I've not just crammed all those theories by myself. So yeah, that was quite a stress interview of all those theories. And the second round was kind of an HR round, because I actually, since I had interned with a startup as well as business, so I actually wanted to know if I would be, interested in corporate and if my actual interest does lie with the research domain. So I told them this story as well, that I actually, it will actually help me in realizing my, interest for research. So that is what I think interested them, that I was authentic and yeah. So I think in interview questions, they need to test your skills, technical skills, and what you can bring them, what you can bring to the table, and what will differentiate you from other research associates that are already working with them. And if you will be a greater, candidate for further growth in the organization.
Okay, I understand. So we have one more question. What advice would you give to students who want to get into the research side?
Research, definitely. If you want to get into research, start, developing the habit of studying research. So the one thing that might, seem to be boring to you initially, but it is what will, eventually help you understand the thinking process of different authors. They actually have very different ideas, and you can read a lot about all these research papers, and you can actually, start mailing to them also. Because when I was doing all these research papers, I was in connect with my professor, and they actually asked me, you can actually, contact this author, this or this person. And I actually contacted them, and I got to their thought process that, while they were doing, designing this particular proof, or they were, using a particular theory for a particular research. So you can actually do so. And if you're interested in research, then definitely try writing some papers after you have done some literature review. There must be some background, some idea in your mind that you want to, there's a question. The research actually starts with a question. If you think that there's a particular thing that is interesting and why is it happening the way it is happening, then, you do a hypothesis testing, then you develop, you think of a research methodology. For example, at KM, I chose research methodology because I knew that I would be interested in research somewhere in the future. So I opted for research methodology, and basic research, involves studying if, smart classes are helping people score, good marks. And, there were many limitations in my study, but it actually helped out me to, understand the basics of research methodology and research, formulating a research design. So if you're interested in research, start from somewhere. And, you have really great professors. Seema ma'am is such a great professor who can, guide you. And, there are other teachers as well in your department maybe who you can get help from, and start, reading as many papers as you can. Yes.
Okay, thank you for that answer. Okay, one more question. How should one manage with society, studies, MBA prep, and with, balance it with internships?
See, this is where you need to, learn multitasking. So prepare a timetable. What, I dreaded, I definitely get your point of view that doing all these at the same time and then attending classes also, and these societies definitely ask for a lot of time devotion. So I really dreaded applying to all these societies only. So I didn't apply for all these societies. And in my master's course, you won't believe that I opted for 7 to 8 research projects, and I opted for the Economic Society. Then I was also the editor for the Economics magazine of IFT. So I took up all the opportunities, you know, that were coming my way. And, you know, this is the time that you will actually enjoy doing all these things. And and if you're thinking of doing MBA, then I'm really telling you, if you start equipping yourself with all these multitasking, right from college, it will actually help you in the B-School. Because it's a belief that in B-School you barely get to sleep for 4 to 5 hours. So just prepare yourself from right now.
Okay, thank you for that answer. And I think that concludes the Q&A section of our session. Also, just one last request from the students. Could you leave your LinkedIn ID or email ID so that we can connect with you later on?
For sure. Should I just mention that in the chat box?
Yeah, sure. That would be great.
Okay. I'll do that right now. Thank you so much, Ms. Kul. Those were some really, interesting questions.
They weren't mine though. I mean, there were the students' questions.
Yeah, Akul was very participative. He asked some questions. Thanks, Akul, for the interesting questions.
Apart from that, so I'd like to hand over the floor to Seema ma'am to just share her thoughts once more. Seema ma'am, over to you.
Thank you very much, Kanika. So the main messages which you have given to the students, I think each one of you who has been present here must remember. First is that planning is very, very important. I fully agree with Kanika. Secondly, multitasking is very, very important. So you shouldn't be afraid of the work which I've been assigning you on daily basis. I think most of the FIC members are present here. So once you do this work, I think all whatever assignment you will be getting in the times to come, it will be easier for you to manage all those things. So the kind of training, it has started here only. So I'm very thankful to Kanika for sparing her time to come and interact with our students and with your juniors, because I think it was long overdue. And I'm also thankful to Nishkarsh that you was prepared to handle, to take up the assignment which I gave him. Rachit and entire FIC team, I'm very, very thankful to you, because ultimately, these programs are meant for all of you only. So once you stand connected, I think my job will be relatively, I'll be taking a back seat, because then you will be on the forefront. And once this alumni network is formally established, then I think our alumni will come forth to handle the all the work which I've been presently coordinating. And I wish all of you very best, and especially Kanika. And I expect you will do very well in RBI. And later on, we see you in IGIDR or maybe PhD from abroad, what you have been aspiring for. And I think IGIDR is also a very good institute. You can always think of working with renowned professors here. Ashima Goel is here. So I wish you all the very best. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
And is there any question from, I think Kshitij wants to ask any question. He has raised his hand. Nishkarsh. Kshitij, given a chance.
No, ma'am. I haven't raised my hand.
Okay. Bhavya Jain.
I cannot.
Yeah, that was a mistake, I think. So we'll just proceed. Kanika, that concludes the session for today. Thank you so much. I mean, I can't thank you enough for this session. The MBAs, up talking about masters, internships, I think that clarifies a lot for us as students, and we really appreciate your line of work. And I mean, personally, as a student, we'd really love to learn about finance and trade. And hence, I mean, this was organized sort of by FIC as well. So we'd love to plug you in our society as well, and just help students learn more about these topics. Once again, thank you for answering all our questions and bearing with us and making this talk super fun and engaging. So thank you once again to everyone who's present.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks and bye.
Thank you, ma'am, for inviting me.
And please join us tomorrow also. We are having a session tomorrow at 4:30.
Yes, ma'am. Okay,
bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone, for participating. Thank you.